all that we seek to do there, God. Help us to be astounded at what we're able to do through the resources that you've already given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So we're at a cool transfer point right now as we move out of the book of Acts. And we're now in Mark chapter 1. The title of the sermon is The Gospel of the Kingdom. And that may just sound like, oh, yeah, gospel, kingdom. We've heard all those words so many times before. And unless they become something commonplace or a yada, yada, yada moment for you, I hope that today we'll have a renewed magnitude for what really is being introduced here on the opening pages of what was likely the first gospel written. And so turn with me to Mark chapter 1. This, by the way, is in no coincidence that we are footing with our daily reading schedule. And this is what we just read on Friday, of course. Why do we do that? Because we want to reinforce resilience. And we know that those who build their house on the rock, on the word of God, and do it, not just simply listen to it, but read it and do it, well, you're going to withstand whatever stuff has been coming our way, and then some. That's the promise of Jesus through his word. And we really do encourage you, tie into these reading groups that we've got. It's the biggest blessing that I've had for sure throughout this whole season of COVID. Never could I have imagined to be so enriched by the word of God as it has been. So we're about to hit the second half of the year. Well, then finish strong. Finish strong. You're still going to experience three of our gospels from the mid-year point on. And also we keep a blog on the daily readings too, just to generate conversation. And we have blog entries for us all through the month of July. It goes to each of the regions on different months. Ours is July, and we will have Mark chapter 5 through the end of Mark and Romans chapter 1, which is the book following this in our reading plan, 1 through 10. So some pretty meaty stuff through there. If you're interested in tackling one of those chapters, we've already had people sign up for 5 through 10 of Mark. But if you're interested in Mark 11 through 16 or Romans 1 through 10, just give me a shout and we'll make sure that we get you on there. We'd love to have sisters especially to jump in there and give thought. It's only 300 words. It's a devotional thought that gets other people thinking and gets the conversation rolling. So amen. But by the way, in case we haven't already recognized and celebrated, we have Andrew with us who was baptized just a couple weeks ago. Andrew, you mind like giving a shout out there? Praise God for that. Okay, Mark chapter 1. Now, we're going to focus, as you see here in verses 14 to 20, because there's a series of distinct stories throughout Mark chapter 1, and we'll honor them as such. We'll go deep into 14 to 20, but just to get context, it's great to just read verse 1. And here we go. Mark 1, verse 1. I'm reading from the ESV, by the way. Mark 1, verse 1. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Many think that Mark's gospel was written primarily to a Roman audience. And I'm not following my own rule that I established earlier to stay in frame for our friends at home. I will behave better. Linda's nodding in approval to me now, I hope. Anyway, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this would have been a phrase that would have actually rung a rather familiar to many of the people that would have received that gospel in the Roman colonies and in the Roman Empire. Why? Because the inscription for one of the great moments, one of the great good news moments for the Kingdom of Rome was the moment of Caesar Augustus. And in 6 BC, an inscription was carved onto a government building that we still have as archaeological extant evidence to this day that says, interestingly, the beginning of the gospel of Caesar Augustus. So, whoa, what is that? How can that be a gospel? The gospel is when you tell about Jesus dying on a cross, right? Isn't that the gospel? Well, the gospel has such a deeper context than perhaps we ever really appreciate, because the word gospel is basically the word, well, for good news. It's often translated good news, the beginning of the gospel, or the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. The word gospel comes from basically two parts of a Greek word, angelion. You know the word angel, right? That is a message or a messenger. So it's a message, and EU, like euphoria, euphonic, euphemism, a eulogy, all of those EU words means good. So it is good news, a good message that needs to be proclaimed. But the technical idea of a gospel probably is maybe best realized from the Battle of Marathon, and the Greeks having prevailed against the Persians in that lopsided battle, and able to then maintain their sovereignty, not being crushed by Persia and Xerxes, that the news was of such momentous good value to all that the runner came all across the plains of Marathon, making his way back to share the euangelion, to share the good news, to share the gospel. It's one of the most classic moments ever of that very idea. Well, as a matter of fact, one that hits home for us that we looked at even just last week was with the Emancipation Proclamation. A euangelion was something that was world-changing in nature, a gospel, a good news of gospel magnitude would have been something that was so big and actually changed the course of human events. And our Emancipation Proclamation is nothing less than that. And when it reached the shores of Galveston and the final corners of our nation finally heard it on June 19th, we've of course now begun to celebrate that idea. We've begun to celebrate a gospel, a gospel in that sense. That probably for me, that where this kind of comes home as something that I remember really hitting me very personally as good news of world-changing magnitude, was in January of 1991. It was during that time, there was no internet, by the way, if you can conceive of such a thing. We had radio and we had television and we had newspapers, and that was about it. But the newspapers came out a couple times a day. That was kind of like a refresh button. But anyway, I was down in my basement in Springfield, Illinois, where I lived. And I remember trying to get, you know, back, you could get AM signals at night that would like bounce all over the place and sometimes catch news from far away. And what I caught caused me to stop in my tracks. And it was kind of the live tweet, also known as a broadcast, of the events in Vilnius, Lithuania. In 1990 and 1991, all of the 15 republics of the Soviet Union were still firmly under the thumb of the Soviets. But the first to declare its independence was Lithuania. But that was not without consequence. And my family, we were always on pins and needles. I had been to Lithuania about 8 years earlier in 1983. When we arrived, it was a very dark and a very oppressed place. Everywhere we went, we were followed by those that were kind of keeping tabs on us. But also when we arrived, I remember looking through the airplane window and along the chain link fence at the airport looked like something of a demonstration. And there were some 70, 80 people along the fence, all waving different sorts of flower garlands. And I asked my mom, what is going on right here? Like, who's on this plane? And she said, we are. That's our family. And it's a family that I had never met, but these are my close family members. This is my great-grandmother. These are my uncles. These are all of my mom's cousins, all of their kids, all of the kind of the iterations that kind of spread out from there that were all there. It was so amazing. And oh, it was such a deep time of bonding and love and connection. So wonderful. But all that did was that then when I was back in the US and trying to keep up with the news, this news ended up becoming really important, because with Lithuania taking such a step, the Soviets mobilized and they brought in one of their elite forces and tanks to come into Lithuania. This was January 11th through January 13th, somewhere near the Arctic Circle, by the way. It was sleet the entire time, sub-zero temperatures through much of this period, but the Soviet tanks came in basically to overrun the news station in Vilnius, the capital of Lithuania. And on that first night, in hearing that the tanks were coming, all the residents of Vilnius initially rallied to the station. It was a big round tower. They rallied to the tower and surrounded the tower with their bodies as the tanks came their way. The tanks kept progressing, but the people maintained their distance. Maintained their stand. Thousands more were added. Ultimately, the tanks rolled over many, machine gun hit many, 1,000 plus were injured, 14 dead in that initial volley. The Soviets drew back and then were readied for the next night to then come again. But with that, all of the buses, all of the trains throughout all of Lithuania just flooded with Lithuanians. Over 100,000 Lithuanians in sub-zero temperatures with very little food, no shelter whatsoever, huddled together and just formed a human shield of unity around the Soviet superpower that was looking to put them back into their place. They stood their ground for day after day. Ultimately, all of the Western reporters and all of the unity from all of the other nations caused the Soviets to blink. And blink they did, the Lithuanians did not. And that was the beginning of the absolute crumbling of the Soviet empire. And Lithuania then flew their flag high. And when that Evangelion hit me in that basement that night in Springfield, Illinois, hearing of the events occurring, they were happening deep into 1, 2 a.m. in Lithuania as all of those events were rolling. It was just a night of just tears of just joy streaming down my face, calling family, just thanking God, just celebrating like never, ever before because of the good news. That's the difference between Christianity and every other religion. Every other religion is a bunch of advisory logical propositions, stuff that you are to live by. But Jesus and Christianity is news. It's good news. Good news to be received like the good news of the gospel of Caesar Augustus, the good news of the Emancipation Proclamation, the good news of the prevailing of Vilnius and Lithuania in face of the tanks of the Soviets. It's that kind of like, yes, it's happened. Like, praise the Lord that this is the reality. This is what we share. We don't share a list of do's and don'ts. We don't share a philosophical construct. We share triumph. We share triumph of a new kingdom, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus, the Son of God. And when Jesus begins to speak in verse 14, here's what the Holy Spirit through Mark captures. Basically, this is Peter's gospel. This is Peter's account. Mark is his cousin, who is his technical term, amanuensis, the guy who writes down his stuff. This is Peter's perspective on the good news. Verse 14, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel, the good news of God, saying the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel, the good news. This is a herald coming into town that should cause all to fall and weep with joy. If we really understood the dimension of what has gone down here, all of history, all of the darkness, all of the plunging under demonic forces, all of that has been overturned. Jesus has decided to intervene on our behalf. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the euangelion, has been proclaimed our way. It's not the Roman Empire, it is the kingdom of God that has been prophesied for so very, very long and is now here in our day. Do we get that that's what confronted us? Do you get even now when you read this? Wow, I am reading what they first would have received all throughout the Roman Empire. All of those would have been so proud at the beginning of the gospel of Caesar Augustus to realize that, crumple that up, throw that away. There's a new king in town. His name is Jesus Christ. And we are the beneficiaries of his victory, triumph, overcoming. And now there is a new kingdom that supersedes any kingdom that could have ever been in place. This is not just us trying to ask people if they want a Bible study. God forbid if that's all that we view this as. This is cosmic. This is transcendent. This is big time. When I think about how eager I was to tell everybody in my family, everybody of Lithuanian origin, about the good news of January 13th, 1991, the beginning of the gospel of Vilnius, Lithuania. To think how excited I was that there's a new kingdom, there's a new sovereignty that is now in place there. My goodness, and now that I get it, I realize that that pales in comparison to what we all get and get to share. We have the honor now of being the heralds, of being those very ones. To think that God could have done it through professional angelions, angels. He had angels. Angels actually could have said it instead of Peter when he went to Cornelius's house in Acts 10. Why not just have the professional angel do the euangelion, right? It's in his job title. Just give it to EU on the beginning and he's got it. But no, instead, God says it's your honor. The thing that's going to send goosebumps up and down your back and your arms, that you're going to enthrall people in all corners, that's your honor. That's what you get to do. And that's what all will hear through you. And so Jesus says, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. In order to get this concept, it takes nothing less than metanoia, a worldview shift of repentance, to completely throw away preconceptions, to have a paradigm shift that blows your mind and helps you to realize, wow, everything that I've been making sense of through my eyes ain't nothing. Now I get that, yeah, even as all these world events go down, there's an overlay of the kingdom of God, the rule of God, the dominion of God, the will of God. And it is going down. May your kingdom come, your will be done, because that's exactly what's happening in our day. And we're the ones that got it. And we're the ones that get to give it. And so Peter, as he hears it now, it says in verse 16, passing along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon Peter, and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Probably no coincidence that Peter's gospel begins with Peter. I mean, after John the Baptist and Jesus, of course, begins with Peter. And Peter's recognition, I get to be in this chain of gospel giving. I get this honor and dignity. I was just a fisherman. And now look, you're going to name kids after me all over the world. not because of my fishing skills, but because of the kingdom of God that is so mind-blowing. Repentance that shifted everything that he could understand so that he could get it. And then the honor of service to the king. And Jesus says, follow me. No small term, because that's the official invitation of a rabbi to a student. Not a casual, hey, come on along, but something akin to an inscribed invitation that I will now mentor you. You will learn from me. You will imitate my ways. You will align yourself with my great mission, and you will then take it forward and make a difference just as I'm making. All of that is in the word follow. No one would have missed it. Later on, when we see other people that follow Jesus and they do so just by him saying, follow, like, really? Like, they just threw away their occupation, their tax collector's booth, just because he walked up and said, follow me. Well, they got what that meant. Just like if you were walking down downtown Norfolk and you passed a recruiting station and there was a Navy recruiter there, and he just simply looked at Ariana and said, Ariana, enlist. Right? In one word, don't you understand everything that is being asked of you? Right? It's because it's a technical term. You're already doing the cost-benefit analysis in your head. Like, well, I don't know if I do. I'm almost done with school. All of that. Like, if it really, maybe it could be cool. I mean, I've seen people have fun, but I don't know. Jackson and I seem to be getting along pretty good right now. That's going. Do I really want to kind of be off at sea when all right? All of that. Why is she able to do all of that in a nanosecond? Why is she able to process it all at the speed of the great Gretzky? Sorry. Not Great Gatsby, the Great Gretzky. Gretzky is the one who thinks all that through in a half a second. Pass it to where they're going to be, right? She's thinking like where we're going to be. How is she able to do all of that? Because it's a word that is technical and therefore freighted or pregnant with massive meaning. Follow. Follow is that word when we see it in the gospel. Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. And immediately, they left it all. They left their nets and followed him. Going on a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. You'd think with James and John, say, hey, James, John, follow me. And they're like, see you, dad. It would require more than that. It doesn't require more than that. Just like the word enlist doesn't require more than that. You heard what he said. That's Jesus. That's the kingdom bearer. That's the one that we've all been. That's him, God, dad. That's him. And he's saying to follow him, off we go. Do you get what we're called to do? Do you get the magnitude of all of this? And it's interesting that Jesus, when he called those that would be the foundation of his ministry, the standard bearers of what it looks like to be his disciple, he said, come follow me and I'll show you how to fish for people. In other words, let's consider what he didn't say. I'm reading from a book that I was reading yesterday, and I'm gonna quote from it here, because I think he did a pretty good job with this. The book is called Unstuck Church, and I'll rewind it here. When Jesus called his first disciples into ministry, he said, come follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people. Let's consider what Jesus didn't say when he summoned those first disciples into ministry. He didn't say, come follow me, and I will teach you spiritual insights. He didn't say, come follow me, and I'll show you how to sing worship songs together. He didn't say, come follow me, and I will gather you together in a home group. He didn't say, come follow me, and I'll show you how to pray. He didn't say, come follow me, and I will make you members of the church.
But he said, come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That's the essentialism. And that's the connection to something as momentous as the gospel of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. The euangelion, the world-changing good news that changes people's lives. Again, when that news lands on your doorstep, everything changes. It rearranges everything in our lives. And we are the ones that have the honor to bring it to the world. This is not about a sales funnel. This is not about numbers. God forbid. And if we ever get that cynical, God forbid. Look at how this gospel makes sure that that never occurs. Too much of Christianity has taken the essentialism of what Jesus has called us to out of Christianity. God forbid we ever do it ourselves. God forbid. It's Jesus's plan A, and there is no plan B. And we have this honor. And to shrink back from it, to fold our arms because we've got excuses about this or that or the way we gather or what we, wow. It's time for us to really rethink what we signed up. I know what I signed up. I know what captivated me versus all the other attempts at Christianity that I had, is coming into a place that took this seriously, that there is a kingdom of God and it's a big deal, that there is a Jesus and he somehow loved me in the midst of my mess and gave all with his blood for me and now has used his servants to love me enough to rearrange their desire for reputation, to stop me on the street and invite me into the good news. Invite me into Jesus. Invite me into his kingdom. Invite me into a repentance that will change and deliver me from everything that was ugly in my life. Thank you, Jesus, for doing exactly that. And he's done it for all of us. Church, let's not get past this momentous moment that the Holy Spirit has laid in our path at just this time and be reminded of what a big deal this is. What a history-changing, momentous good news that this really is. And the fact that this good news has been laid into our trustworthy hands to carry it forward and let other people know, not about a philosophical approach to new living, but about Jesus, our King, his prevailing, his victory, the good news, the kingdom, the deliverance, the intimate love, the intimate impact that it has on us and on all others. My goodness, if we ever stop thinking of all of it in that way and shrink it down to something else, I don't want to be part of that. I don't want to be part of that for a second. Because when I finally understood what this was, I left everything in a heartbeat, realizing how wonderful God has just opened my eyes to understand that I've got a life of great significance. When my brother and I were little, we would listen to the stories of Lithuania, of the freedom fighters, of our uncle after World War II, well before the events of 1991. Fighting in the woods, revolution against the Soviets, railing against the oppression that was going on in their world. And I remember as we sat at my grandmom's knees and she would tell us of the stories of her brother, the Tiger, who led one of the partisan resistance companies. I just watched a documentary earlier today called The Invisible Front, where they actually recount one of the battles where my uncle, the Tiger, came out with a machine gun and two of the other companies came and they did a kind of a pincher move on the Soviets and actually drove them back. And one of the
early resistances against them. And I remember how my brother and I were like, oh my God, what are we going to, how are we going to be part of something significant in our lives? And then as we got older and older, we thought, well, I don't know if that's ever going to come. And then one year after that radio tower, that television tower, time of good news, I realized, because it was 1 year later, that God put someone in my path. Just 1 year later, in 1992, and later in 93, I became a disciple. But in 1992, put somebody in my path 1 year later to tell me good news that would make that excitement over Lithuania pale in comparison, realizing that to God, the nations are but a drop in the bucket. They're but dust on the scales. Because I suddenly realized there is a kingdom of God. Oh, and it cannot be denied. And it's big time. And thank you, God, for having the mercy on me, a mess, to know this, to learn this, and to be part of this. And we all get to. That's the significance of our lives. We're not to live lives of quiet desperation, wondering how am I ever going to have meaning? Not that that's the end all and be all, but that we get to live lives filled with Jesus at every turn, enthralled with Jesus at every turn, excited and grateful for Jesus at every moment in his kingdom. Let's not forget that every one of us were disrupted by Jesus, who looked at you and said, come, follow me, and I will teach you how to fish for men. Amen.